Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Salzburg, and next on Pet Owners Hotline, we'll be talking about first aid for your pet, so stay tuned.
Studios on the Daytona State College East Campus.
Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Salzburg, your host for Pet Owners Hotline. Ever wonder what to do when your pet is lying around not feeling itself or is hurt? Well, our guest, Dr. John Bass of Bayshore Animal Hospital, is here to discuss some home first aid for pets. Hey, Dr. Bass, good to see you.
Good to see you, Mark.
Well, before we get started about this, I really want to tell everybody out there, because I'm pretty excited about it, you are going to start on your term as president for the Florida Veterinary Medical Association. Congratulations.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Tell me a little bit about the FVMA.
My term starts the 1st of May, and I'll be president for a year. The Florida Veterinary Medical Association is basically a professional organization that represents about 3,500 veterinarians, many of them practicing veterinarians in the state of Florida.
Excellent. Well, I know you've been involved with that for quite a few years in some capacity or another.
I have.
And how many? Over 20 years, right? Something like that?
Pretty close to 20 years I've been involved in organized veterinary medicine, yes.
Excellent. So tell me a little about your practice. I know that you're kind of backing off a little bit now, but you're still doing some...
I'm still there. I'm just not there all the time like I was before, usually 1 or 2 days a week.
Well, good. We'd like to join all of you welcome you to join us tonight. If you have any questions that come up that you need answered, please give us a call at 1-800-901-9238. So, Dr. Bass, tonight we're going to talk a little bit about what people can do in their home in case an emergency arises with their pets. Give me an idea about what you have here.
Well, what I've got here is actually a first aid kit that's made for pets. And as we go through some of the things that are in here, you'll see that they're pretty general. You can put this together by yourself, or you can buy a kit that's like this, that's pre-prepared. They're very nominally priced. Most pet stores would carry something like this. And just to start going through a few of the things in here, there's some bandage material in here. As you well know, when you come up with bandage material, there are a lot of different kinds out there. You want something that you can put on that'll do the job as far as putting pressure on a wound or a bleeding wound without putting so much pressure that it cuts off the circulation. So you want something that you can't put on too tightly.
And I like that stuff. That's vet wrap or Coban,
yes,
or something like that.
And usually you can tear that with your fingers too.
And it sticks to itself, but it doesn't stick all on the animal. And it's easier doing that because it's hard to apply pressure just, you know, by your hand of the dog moving around or a cat that's moving around.
And bleeding wounds are probably one of the more common things that people might run into, bleeding toenails as well. And so usually the principle is just put pressure on the wound and you can usually stop the bleeding.
Excellent. Okay.
We've got some roll gauze, as well as some gauze sponges that you can use. Got to have cotton balls.
And an emergency, okay, just since we're talking about bleeding as an emergency, you know, an animal gets a cut or gets stuck on something or stuck or whatever. As far as first aid, what's the thing that you want people to concentrate on?
Well, first of all, don't panic.
Right.
And second of all, you want to put pressure on the wound to stop the bleeding.
So get the bleeding.
Unless there's some other problem with clotting, then you should be able with pressure to stop any bleeding wound in 5 minutes.
Right.
Just by keeping pressure on the wound.
And that's a good point. So the most important thing is get that bleeding stopped however you can. Like you said, apply pressure. And the wrap comes in handy for that. Okay, good. And we don't really care about cleanliness at this point. Like if it's a dirty wound,
no.
We worry about that later.
No.
Just get it the bleeding stuff.
Okay. You've got to get that stopped.
And so what else do you have in there?
We've got a generalized antibacterial ointment. Should have something like that in there for applying to any bite wounds that you might come across or in potentially infected wounds, that is after you clean them. There's a pair of gloves in here. We use gloves for everything nowadays, so you probably should, easy to put a pair of those in there.
And what is that liquid stuff there? Is that eye wash?
Always we want to be concerned about the possibility of something getting into their eyes, just like would get into our eyes, the way the wind's blowing nowadays, spring. Things can get into the eye. And so this is just a general eye wash that you can use to flush anything out of
and
the eye.
And you can use human eye wash that you get from your drugstore or whatever.
Or you can use water.
And actually, this is a great segue because we have a phone call, I think, about an eye. Go ahead, call. You're on the air.
Hi, how are you doing today, sir?
Very good. What's going on?
Good. Well, what happened is that my Chihuahua left eye is, she has a kind of allergy going on with her eye.
Right.
And
is it red, irritated?
It's like red and irritated, but it's also showing like a, how do you say, like she's kind of blindish, like you're going blind in her left eye. It's swollen.
Okay. Well, I'll let Dr. John Bass, I know what I would tell you to do, but Dr. Bass will take a stab at that.
Well, I happen to have two Chihuahuas myself, so I know a little bit about it. If especially if it's one eye and you think it's swollen red, one of the diseases that Chihuahuas can have is glaucoma, which is abnormal pressure in the eye, and so that should be checked by a veterinarian. Absolutely.
So it doesn't sound like an emergency. If it was red and irritated and squinty or something like that, you might use an eye flush or something like that. But it sounds like this may be more than that. So probably the best thing is get to, like you said, to a veterinarian. And actually, we have another phone call. So we'll take this phone call. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air.
Right now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'd like to ask the doctor if he recommends getting the three-year rabies vaccination.
Okay. She wants to know if you recommend getting the three-year rabies vaccination.
I certainly do. The way the vaccination with rabies works, the first time they need a vaccination, usually that's when they're puppies most of the time, and then they need to be revaccinated in 1 year, and that can be every 3 years thereafter. And so, yes, I strongly recommend that.
Okay. I think some people have the understanding or the thought that the three-year rabies vaccination is a more potent vaccine, and that's not true.
It's not. It's just they know from testing the vaccines that an animal can maintain the proper amount of immunity for 3 years.
So by all means, it's a good idea. We do have another phone call, and I think it's about something that we might have talked about tonight. So let's go ahead. Go ahead, Carl. You're on the air.
Hi, this is Sydney from New Smyrna Beach.
Hi, Sydney.
How are you?
I'm great, thanks. How are you?
Great. Fine, thanks.
What's your question?
I'm calling about bloat. I had a dog die from bloat. I have boxers, and I understand deep-chested dogs are prone to having bloat. My question is it better to feed your dog in an elevated bowl or a bowl on the floor?
Okay. Dr. Bass, what do you think?
Well, boxer is certainly one of those dogs that has that could potentially have a problem with bloat. Classically, we say the deep-chested breeds. Me personally, I don't know that it matters where you feed them. I think it matters when you feed them, how much you feed them, and what their activity levels are after you feed them. And so, in my opinion, those things are more important than how high the food dish is.
That's a good point. I think I agree. I think that there's a lot of problems with people letting dogs eat big meals, drink a bunch of water, and then go run outside, run around and stuff like that. But some of those deep-chested dogs, especially the dogs that are called brachycephalic that have the squished-in nose, they tend to eat and swallow a lot of air. So that maybe makes them more prone to it. So, slowing down the dog, doing things like that in terms of what they eat might help also. But I think we have one more call, and then we're going to go back to the discussion.
Okay.
Go ahead, caller. You're on the air.
I have a parrot. And he got bit. I have a parrot, and he got bit about a year ago. And he has diarrhea constantly. He shoots it about 3 feet away. And there's no blood showing when he got bit by a dog. Is there anything I can do for the diarrhea?
This is a parrot?
Parrot.
Okay, a parrot that has diarrhea for about a year. It probably It probably has nothing to do with the dog bite, is what my guess would be, first of all. And if it's had diarrhea for that long, I think, I hate to say this, but there's nothing we can answer about that right here. I think probably the most important thing you should do is find a veterinarian in your area who specializes in birds and call them and get your parrot in to see him, because, you know, having loose stool like that, depending on the type of bird, is not right. So probably the best thing that, you know, would be to see a veterinarian, because there could be any number of reasons. And I think, I won't tell you I know this, but I think it's probably not related to the dog bite. So what else do we have in this kit here that we can talk to these people about?
One thing that's in here is a very thinly folded up blanket. I don't know that you need something like this specifically, but you should have access to towels, blanket, something like that, just to wrap up your pet if they're injured. And you have to, especially if you have to transport them some way, a lot of times that's the easiest way to transport them. One of the things that's, one of the things that's in here right now, there's scissors and tweezers. Scissors, you want to be careful. That's just for clipping extra long hair out of the way. You don't want to clip hair that's right close to the skin, or you might inflict a wound in there. The tweezers, if pets get a sand spur or something in their paw, it's a lot easier, many times easier to pull those things out with a pair of tweezers than to use your own hand.
Let's go back to the towel thing that, you know, there's something I think is important. I don't know if we talked about the muzzling. Have we talked about that?
We haven't.
Okay. Using a towel or a blanket, like a big beach towel or something like that, is actually a great way to not only transport your animal, yeah, but to restrain.
Can be used as a means of restraint. And one of the things that I was going to mention that is not in here, and that's anything to muzzle a pet with, even if it's a regular muzzle that you can buy, or if it's a piece of heavy twine or a piece of nylon stocking, you should have something in here that you can muzzle a pet with, because if a pet's injured, their natural response is to bite, many times out of pain, and you don't want to get yourself hurt, then you're not going to be able to help your pet at all. So muzzle, and then another thing that's not in here is a short leash. Many times people don't carry leashes with them, especially in situations where they might encounter something in a hurry. If you've got something like that in this kit that's really short, then that's a good thing to have in there.
And that's a great
idea. You can usually
get
those from your veterinarian, many of us can.
Yeah, they make those slip knot leashes. Those work great. And actually, in a pinch, they can make a muzzle, too, because you can tighten it down, just wrap it a few times. And again, you know, it's a good point. It doesn't matter whether you would swear to anybody that your dog or your cat would never bite you. Under these circumstances, all bets are off. An animal's hurt. They strike out frequently in these ways that you can't predict. And if you're laying over there trying to stop your own bleeding, you're not going to be able to help your pet. So putting some sort of a muzzle or a restraint of some sort. I mean, you can even use a towel or something like that to wrap around, you know, the head of your dog. And please, that's something to remember to do if there is an injury. Now, actually, I want to go back to that earlier question, because bloat is an emergency. Right. And everybody probably knows about bloat. But tell us, first of all, a little bit what bloat is, what happens, and why is it an emergency?
Well, first of all, we don't know everything there is to know about bloat, which makes it a little bit difficult to study as far as the universities go. Now, what I mean by that is we know certain things that are associated with it, but we don't know certain things we can say, this, this, and this, if you do it, you will produce bloat. So we try to identify those breeds that are prone to it.
And name some breeds.
Would usually be Boxer. Great Dane probably is the one that made it famous. Irish Setter, German Shepherd, Standard Poodle I've seen it in.
Just as a note, and this is just a note just to remind people, you're talking about those breeds that are more more commonly associated with. I had a dachshund that bloated. Had a basset hound, well, not me personally, but a client that had a basset hound that bloated. So any breed, it can happen to.
And one of the classic things that you might see is you might notice that the stomach is distended, particularly after eating. But you can't always go by that. They don't necessarily have to have just eaten a big meal. They may have eaten, say, some bread or a certain type of new dog food or something and been drinking a lot of water. that swells in the stomach, produces gas, and you'll see a distended abdomen would be your first tip-off.
The other thing we notice is that a lot of times they get very distressed.
Absolutely.
You know, bleeding or trying to retch is another thing that's a symptom.
So, and when Dr. Salzburg says retching, he's mainly talking about trying to vomit, but really not being able to vomit. So that's an important thing to think about there. And that really is an emergency situation. People with those breeds that are predisposed need to know how to get and when to get to their veterinarian or their emergency clinic.
And that's a good point that we talked about a little bit earlier, what you said was important to include in your emergency kit.
In this little pocket in the kit here, what I think you should have, you can put a card with your veterinarian in here, and you can put a card with the nearest emergency clinic in there. That way you've got it right there, you know when to use it, you know how to get there, you know how to call right away. You don't have to wait, fumble through the phone book, look it up on the internet or whatever.
And most of the time, if you don't have a card for those, if you call your regular veterinarian, they're required to have an emergency number.
Absolutely.
So if you call your veterinarian, even if it's after hours, you should get an answering machine or an answering service that will give you an emergency clinic number or an emergency number for you to call. Just kind of another point, and again, I'm glad that the young lady called, but bloat is a dire emergency.
Yes.
It has to be. This is, and unfortunately, there's not a whole lot you can do at home. You have to get them to your regular veterinarian or to an emergency clinic, and it has to be quick.
Yes.
Because they can die. Actually, I've had it happen where a dog has passed away in as little as about 45 minutes. So it can be fast. Now, it's not always, and it's not always that fast, but it can be.
You just have to be vigilant.
Well, speaking about that, we have another phone call. Hopefully, it's as good as the ones we've had so far. Go ahead, call. You're on the air.
Good evening. My name's Mary Jane. I have an 8-year-old Peek-a-Poo that's a rescue dog from the Humane Society. She was spayed when she was about 6.5, 7 years old. She started displaying odd symptoms that we've not been able to diagnose or find out what's causing it. She sweats. And I mean, when she sweats, she pours sweat. And she's not necessarily running around. She can be laying in my arms, sound asleep. And it's like, she sleeps with me too. She has hot flashes. You can feel her body just heat up like a woman having had hot flashes. I know what they are. And she pours sweat from her stomach on the soft part of her stomach and all along her back. I've had all kind of tests done trying to find out what's causing it.
Okay, well, I have some ideas, but I'm going to let Dr. Bass take that one.
Well, it certainly sounds like it's quite unusual because most of the time dogs don't sweat except their nose and the pads of their feet. So for them to sweat in the skin is a bit unusual. I would tend to think that that although this could have a hormonal aspect to it, it's probably not estrogen related. But
And I agree. That's kind of an unusual thing because dogs don't have the traditional sweat glands that we think about that produce this sort of watery, salty substance. They do have sweat glands in their feet, but they're more actually kind of a greasy sweat, an oily sweat. So this may be some sort of a thing and some glandular dysfunction. And, you know, again, maybe it's a hormonal shift. It sounds like a poser, and I certainly would tell you to continue to pursue some sort of diagnostics. You may want to go maybe to the University of Florida or something like that, to the vet school, to see if they can figure it out. We have some more phone calls, so we're going to stay answering calls, okay? Go ahead, call. You're on the air.
Hi there. This is Diane from Orlando. I have two big, hairy golden retrievers, and usually this time of year, they're shedding tremendously, and they're very itchy. I brush them. I've given them baths. They don't have fleas. They are just itchy, itchy, itchy. They're biting themselves. They are prone to hot spots, and I've just finished with one on each of them where they have to wear cones for about a week or so. And now there's no hot spots, but they're just so itchy. You know, I've tried using like Benadryl and things, which I hate to keep giving them drugs consistently. Any thoughts on the shedding and the itching for these big, poor, hairy dogs as our seasons change here?
Lots of thoughts. Go ahead, Dr. Bass.
Well, as far as the shedding goes, you're in a transition time, so you're going to get some shedding. I suspect what you're concerned about is the shedding associated with the chewing and the scratching. And with a golden retriever, and I've had several myself, that's one of the top 10 allergy-prone breeds. And so when we talk about allergies, we're not always just talking about fleas, especially this time of year, spring. The allergies that affect us that classically cause hay fever signs or sinus problems with us, the skin tends to be the shock tissue in the dog. And so they itch, and their response to that itch is to scratch. And you're going to have to try to find something, whether hopefully Benadryl is one that sometimes will work, antihistamines, more frequent bathing, working through your veterinarian, with your veterinarian, try to find out the things that you can use that will mediate some of that itchiness.
And we actually talked a little bit, and I think it's worth mentioning just for a second here, is if you have a dog that acutely becomes very, very itchy, mm-hmm. you told me a little bit, just an easy, quick thing that'll at least give them some relief.
Which is a good thing for you to know along the lines of first aid, even though it's not in a kit. You can wet them down with cool water right out of the tap. Not hot water, not warm water, just cool water right out of the tap for about 10 or 15 minutes. And many times that will buy you 12, 24 hours of relief, especially if it happens at night. I had it happen to one of mine at night one time. So it can be exasperating. Or a weekend till you can get to a veterinarian, that'll buy you a little bit of time.
That's a good time. That's a good point. And about those chronic itchy dogs, right? Allergies, the most common symptom of allergies in dogs is some sort of dermatitis, itchy skin, breaking out, whatever. And like you said, that breed in particular. We'll go ahead and take another call. Go ahead, caller, you're on the air. Nope, no caller.
Thank you.
Hello.
Yes, hi.
How are you?
This is Ellen Levine. I'm fine, thank you.
What's your question tonight, Ellen?
My question for you is this. I had tuned in, and I heard you speaking of canine bloat. What I'm concerned with is, have you ever been associated with or have heard of any reported cases in regards to feline bloat?
I have not.
I've never heard of what's the classic. I mean, we call this bloat, but there's a real specific, it's sort of a combination thing. It's where the stomach swells and then twists. That's the true bloat. It's got a much longer medical term, but it basically swells. I don't mean swells, but fills up with air and then sort of floats in the stomach, and then because of its attachment, it twists. And when it twists off the esophagus and the intestine, so then it becomes an acute problem. I have never heard of a true bloat where that occurred in a cat. I had a cat once that had what we thought, or what the owners thought, was a bloat because he got a very distended abdomen. Turned out, I think, what happened in that cat was actually the cat got into some sort of a breathing respiratory thing that where he was panting excessively, and when he was doing that, he was actually swallowing air. So he was doing what's called aerophagia, where he was swallowing air, and he kept swallowing air because he was frantically breathing and swallowing and all that, and he got bloated because of that, but it didn't twist. So basically, with that, it fortunately for the cat, I just gave him a mild sedative. He relaxed, started to burp the air up, and he was better. And then we went on to find out ultimately what happened to him. But the true gastric dilatation and volvulus, that bloat where it twists, I've never heard of it in a cat. I can't imagine that it couldn't happen. It's just not a real common thing. Mm-hmm. And I think let's go back and we got a few more things. I know there was a couple things that we want to talk about.
Well, one of the things I wanted to mention, we were talking about boxers and the brachycephalic breeds at this time of year, is heat stroke, because that's certainly something with the popularity of those dogs, the French bulldogs as well, that they can become overheated very easily. They can become overheated in an air-conditioned car. So people should know how to handle that. And usually the best thing to do is just start to try to cool them down. Again, cool water. You don't have to pack them in ice. In fact, we wouldn't recommend that.
Right.
But just cool water, running tap water over them for 15, 20 minutes, usually will bring that body temperature down and has a good chance of getting you past that critical stage. That's another one, though. If it continues, they need to be seen at a at an emergency clinic or a veterinary hospital.
And that's a great point, because we're getting ready to come into summertime, and people have to remember that. You know, walking your dog in the middle of the day is probably not a great, even if it's not a, you know, one of these snuffly dogs. But it's just important to remember that, you know, get them out early in the morning, get them out in the evening after the sun's gone down as much as possible. Never, ever, ever, I don't care if you're in the shade and you crack the windows open, you leave them open, don't leave them in a car. It gets hot in the shade here, and it's hot enough for some of these dogs to get into trouble, and it can happen pretty quickly. But unfortunately, we're almost out of time. And I think it's about time that we close up. Well, we have like 20 more seconds. Okay. What can you say quickly in 20 seconds?
I would just mention, just to carry that a little bit farther, people have to keep in mind, as we were talking, that dogs don't sweat, that these breeds, their way of getting rid of body heat is through the lungs, through their breathing, and that's their weakest part of their anatomy to begin with. So that makes sense if people will think about it, and that just should... If they can't breathe well to begin with, they're not going to be able to lower that body temperature.
Okay, we ran over our 20 seconds. Okay, we're out of time, and I want to thank Dr. Bass for coming tonight and talking to us a little bit about emergencies and how to deal with them at home. I want to welcome you to come to next week. I'm sure we're going to be on again next week and see what we have to talk about. If you didn't get your question answered, you can email me at wdsctv@daytonastate.edu. We'll see you next time on Pet Owners Hotline.